see familiar new faces. This is our second time with Dr. BlueEye, and she always fills the room, so we can always come on that. I want to start us off tonight by reading the center's land acknowledgement. The University of Akron is located on lands that have been home to many diverse nations, including the Ohio Seneca and Cayuga, the Lenni Lenape, the Miami, the Shawnee, the Wyandot, the Odawa, and the Ojibwe nations. The region we now call Ohio takes its name from a Cayuga word meaning good flowing stream. To honor the land and lives of Indigenous nations past and present, the coming center commits to using our facilities and our collections to educate and uplift, to provide space and audience, and to amplify voices, art, knowledge, and the cultural experiences of Indigenous people.
Hi, everyone. I'm really glad you're here. Thanks for being here. I'm Dr. Jody Cairns. I'm the director of the Institute, which is this beautiful space where you're sitting right now. After a well-attended and well-received discussion for the 2022 Rethinking Race series, we're so pleased to have Dr. LaDonna BlueEye back to the Institute as our first ever speaker for our brand new fall lecture series. So thank you. Today she'll be telling us a history of Two-Spirit and LGBTQ identity in Native American community. Some of you already heard me say this. If you have questions, Dr. BlueEye wants us to write them down. So there are note cards and pencils kind of around the room. Fran has some, there are some back there. So please write your questions down and Fran and I will grab those and we'll read them to LaDonna after the lecture. Dr. BlueEye earned a BA from the University of Central Oklahoma, a Master's of Public Health from the University of Oklahoma Health Sciences Center, and her PhD from the School of Public Health at Indiana University in Bloomington. Dr. BlueEye is an enrolled member of the Choctaw Nation, and thank you for being here.
Great, thank you. All right. That's awesome. Thank you very much, everyone, for being here, and a lot of faces I know, and again, as she said, some new faces. I, of course, want to first thank the Cummings Center for the History of Psychology and also the Portage Path Collaborative, who was instrumental in starting right here in Akron, the North American First Nations, First People's Day, thank you. The name got longer and longer, and my memory is just only so much. So anyways, thank you all for being here. As I said last time I was here, the one thing that all of us have is time, and that's the great equalizer, because it doesn't matter how much money you do or do not have. So I do thank you for spending your time here with me tonight. I'll try to make it worthwhile. I know earlier in the week, Sarah Eaglehart spoke at the library, which unfortunately I was not able to attend. However, one thing that Sandra reported, she said, is that Native American communication is really very circular. And so I've made an outline that I probably won't exactly follow, but I might. So just to give you a little bit of overview, I'm going to talk about right to conquest and how all of this wraps in with LGBT in our Native community. So rite of conquest, are the relationship of LGBT Native Americans with spirituality, how we were, as a race, nearly wiped out, annihilated. There's some terms and language that we'll look at. Roles within the tribe of what we call Two-Spirit people, and a resurgence of our own history and where we are heading, right? So first, just some very big general definitions that we're talking about: gender versus sexual orientation. So sexual orientation refers to the emotional, romantic, sexual, affectionate attraction to others. And these are very, very basic. Any one of these slides could probably be a lecture unto themselves. But gender is socially defined, and it dictates one place and one role within someone's community. Right. So I want to start by talking about, actually, the right of conquest was international law at one time. And basically, the right of conquest is if you can win a war with someone, then you can take their land, right? And so this was a belief that was used here in the United States, particularly, of course, to take native lands. So we have the right to conquer. The other thing that goes very, very close in hand with that is the doctrine of discovery, which, of course, comes from the church. So that had that spiritual basis. And the doctrine of discovery said that anywhere that that their people or countrymen landed, if they weren't Christian, then they had the right to say, okay, we discovered this. And so now it's ours, all right? So the interesting thing about this is we could talk about the history and all that did, but one really great thing that happened for us, believe it or not, is that the people, the early people who followed these doctrines, they wrote down our history for us, right? That's in many ways the only way we know that how things used to be. Now, within our tribe, stories are passed down through generations and from person to person, and that's how we learn. Being in academia, I know that that doesn't count unless it's written down somewhere. So fortunately, or unfortunately, I guess, with this history, it is written down. It's written down in personal journals, which people used to do in the day. It was written down in formal letters back to their country saying, this is what we found, and it's ours now, so give us more money so that we can go somewhere else. And also through art and paintings. So that's how we know this history that I heard of at a young age, and then as I got older, actually found some of this in the writings. So one of the early explorers in this area, Hernando de, I'm going to mess it up, Alarcon. When he went into Native American ceremonies, or what they called houses of worship, what he wrote about was seeing one or two males with mannerisms of women in speech and clothing. He described chiefs as having a carnal, foul intercourse on feast days and holidays, almost like a religious rite and ceremony. They didn't have the word orgy back then, so they went with that. But I think that's pretty much what he was describing. Now, one of the things about Hernando he is one that we would think of as an anthropologist or ethnographer who actually did just simply write these things down. He was not one of the rulers who did some of the things that we're going to talk about in a moment. So this is one of the early drawings or paintings from the early 1500s. Theodore de Bry. One of the conquistadors was Balboa. And so when Balboa came here and he saw how Native Americans were living, and so it didn't matter if a person was born male or female, it could be two women who lived together, it could be two men, it could be a lot of fluid orientation, a lot of fluidity. So Balboa decided that this was evil and actually set dogs loose on about 40 to 50 men who had lain with other men. So that is part of that history of being targeted by outsiders. So while our lives were accepted and known and valued within our own community, outsiders coming in immediately took to attempting to destroy. So those who weren't killed, and a lot of times this was taken out more amongst the men in the reading that I've seen, that the what we call LGBTQ people were used as slaves, right? So we either kill them or we use them for our own goods. So these are just other pictures from the same artist who is has documented this for us. So this one, he is titled Hermaphrodites as Laborers, and so it's the same thing. We conquer, we take, and then we take over the people. This particular painting is newer. This is called Dance to the Burdock. And so that term, burdock or burdash, it's pronounced a couple different ways. That is a negative term that at the time it meant a young male who was used by another older male for sexual purposes. And that word, that's a term that was introduced, right? That was a term that was not used in our own tribes. But it was the closest thing to the language, I guess, that they used at that time, right? So this particular dance, what they found in one of the journals is that the person in the center is I guess, preening, for better, for other words. And the men around her, which was actually someone who was born male and chose to wear and do the roles of a woman. This particular dance had that person standing in the center, and then all the other men in the tribe would circle and dance and sing and chant. And the goal of that was to get her to lift her eyes and to look at them. And it, if one of the dancers could get that, then they're the winner. They win this. So this was not something that was demeaning. This was simply a part of ceremonies or dance that was used. So what Catlin said, it's what he described it as one of the most unaccountable, disgusting customs that I've ever met in Indian country. I should wish that it might be extinguished before there was any more recording of it. So they wrote about it, and they had paintings from that time. And even though this is the artist that drew that, he felt like that's all we need. We don't want to carry this forward. Okay, so I've already talked about this. So I've talked about the historical term. It's used by non-natives, which is a very familiar story to us, in that our written language was written by outsiders. Most of that was written by religious people. So my native language is Choctaw language. My mom didn't speak a word of English until she was 5 years old. My grandmother was stronger in Choctaw than in the English language. So the words that we have are those that outsiders have written. So as an adult, I went to classes when I lived in Oklahoma years ago, because I wanted to just take a refresher on the Choctaw language course, because I had not spoken fluently since I was maybe a little kid. And even then, I understood it much more than I could communicate and speak. However, so I went, and one of the first things the teacher said was, "We have no curse words in the Choctaw language." And so I raised my hand, and I just like cursed a blue streak in my language. And she was like, "Yeah, I don't know what that means." And I was like, "Yes, you do. I know you do. I know you do, because, you know, and those are the words we always remember best, right?" So Two-Spirit is a fairly new term in Native American communities. The term Two-Spirit is from an indigenous perspective. It's also a spiritual perspective. So it's about fluidity, gender exploitation. It's not sexual orientation. And again, this is a fairly modern term that we're using now. It's just sort of taken hold. So the term is a lot more gender fluid than people think. So it's not just the spirit of male and female. So again, if we think of a circle and we have a line, then there's male and there's female. We also think of that circle that goes all the way around it. And so people can fall anywhere within that circle. Right? So these next few slides I'm certainly not going to go over all of them. However, the important part about this is that these are different tribes and the different words that are in their language, right? So some of them are words of, some are just descriptions. Some of them are a slur. But most of them are pretty much like the words you see here, boy, girl. Some of them are like man that dresses like a woman, something like that. And so this work was actually researched by a man named Harlan Pruden, who's a friend of mine. So again, these aren't something that I'm going to read to you, but just the number of tribes that we have who do have language and who did have the language to talk about what we just basically say as Two-Spirit. There's one, the Inuit, that's infant whose sex changes at birth. So, and I think this will be available later if people want to go and actually research and look through these a little more closely. Just keeps going on and on, right? So I just think it's so interesting that even though our language was written by people who were not a part of the community, and that language was written from their perspective and written from their own personal values, that some of these words still survive. And that we, in fact, did have words and language for this that I'm not going to find in a language class. All right, so when we talk about two spirits, which I'm going to use for the rest of the time, when we talk about two spirits, it was believed that it was one person who held the spirit of basically in the most basic terms of male and female. And of course, that's remembering that there's the big circular everything else in between, right? So it was believed that people who were Two-Spirit had special powers and abilities to walk in between worlds. So between our world and between whatever, the heavens or whatever's out there, right? So it was believed that a Two-Spirit person could actually walk between two worlds. And because of that, they were able to walk in both what was recognized as male and female world. That they were able to see multiple viewpoints. See, this was a gift. This was not something to be ashamed of. This was someone who had something just a little extra in their outlook. So it was also very much linked to spirituality. So it was believed that this person could communicate between the spirit world and the human world. And so their roles in the tribe were often things like a mediator, a leader, a medicine person, healer, singer, drummer, hunter. Some of those roles that are very, very sacred in our communities. So one of the other things that Two-Spirit people were living between the two worlds, which makes sense, is that they were also trained in and held a very important role in death, and that space in between death and as people are dying, right? So assisting spirit from earth to the spirit world. There were many different funeral rites, and so some of them were platforms. Some of them had to do with ceremonial garments. Some of them picked bones out of what we would think of as cremated, someone that's cremated. Construction of where the ceremonies were held. So there were a lot of ceremonial rites that this person could partake in, that others look to them. So it's interesting because in my family, that's one of the things that I kind of grew up with. If there was someone in the community who was dying and my mom and grandmother would go visit them, and I would go with them and tag along. So I grew up not afraid of death. So, but not everyone's in that comfort zone, right? Two-spirit people, the role also was as an observer, right? So if there were treaties being written, if there were meetings between different tribes, they were there to observe and provide counsel, right? Because especially if you think of someone that needs mediation, right? There's two distinct points of view that are often just so entrenched that it's not going to change. So having that person that could actually see both of the things that were going on was very important. And also strong powers of observation. So it was believed that some two-spirit people could tell if someone was lying, which, of course, if you're going to sign a treaty with someone or try to come to a place of peace, I guess that'd be a good characteristic to have. So mediators, so that would also be marriages, divorces, arguments between people, communications between male, female, and also intergenerational communication between elders and the younger generation. So these rules that we had, that outsider came in and made this something very negative that our history actually went, had to go dormant or underground in order to save ourselves and our culture. So these special things we didn't know till later, or we heard from stories, right? Another role is protectors, caretaking, family, children, choosing where to set up camp, ensuring the safety of the community. So, as I've mentioned before, the people in these positions that we call two-spirit were held in very, very high esteem. So they were respected in many nations, but at times there was also some fear. They were seen as medicine people, seen as positive, could also be viewed, I guess, in the negative way. They might be honored or they might be dealt with harshly. This was a really fine line to walk. And especially, I think, more so as things started to change, right? So one of the things that I talked about previously, or last time I spoke, was the American Indian religious freedom. It was outlawed in the late 1800s. The Secretary of the Interior, again, we're called heathens, again. So in 1883, the Secretary of the Interior said, you know, these practices must cease. So all of these religious rites, your ceremonies, your powwows, your sweat lodges, all sorts of ceremonies had to stop. It was punishable by being in jail and later actually imprisonment. Now, when I talk about this, a lot of people ask, do you know anyone who was imprisoned for going to their powwows or going to different ceremonies? And the answer is no. But if you think of that power imbalance, right, I do remember as a child when we were going to a powwow and we had to keep that location a secret. Because if people found out and destroyed the arbor or destroyed the sacred ground, who would we report it to? We couldn't go to the police because what we were doing was illegal. So to this day at ceremonies, there is still that belief that people will, not people, that Native Americans will be arrested or prosecuted. There's still that very, very strong belief. So even a little bit later, 20, 30 years later, the Bureau of Indian Affairs wrote to the reservation agents and said that the males had to cut their hair. That wearing short hair by men is going to be a great advancement for Native people. And also then they started denying food and also putting people at hard labor. So this further pushed, we're up to about 1900 now, that further pushed those beliefs and that history even further down. Excuse me. So just to follow up on that is that for some tribes, asking the hair to be cut is like asking for crops to stop growing, because it's just a natural thing that our hair would grow. So there are some tribes even today with their personal body, like if they clip their fingernails, they have to save them and put them back in the earth in a special way, right? So so what happened and what had been happening all those years definitely changed the course of our history, particularly with Two-Spirit people. So again, there were those forced cultural changes. The way that Europeans and Spanish conquistadors and the way Native Americans saw life were at completely different ends, and that whole circle thing was not happening. And that was not it. So there was forced Christianity, the government boarding schools, having language taken away. Two-Spirit people, in addition to all Native Americans who had to change and hide our Native ways, Two-Spirit people in particular had to hide their identity as a form of self-preservation. Right, so this is a picture of a boarding school in which all these children are made to look the same and to look uniform, and all the colors and all the things that are important to a tribal people are gone. My mom went to a school like this, and she told me they were not allowed to speak their native language, which was the only language that she knew. She did tell me, though, that her and a friend would go out as far out on the land as they were allowed to, and they would very quietly sing their Choctaw songs so they wouldn't forget them. So this picture is a before and after of the same person who was in a boarding school. And here we see the same thing, a younger male who was in a boarding school as he showed up, and then after he changed and became really looked as what they wanted him to be. So some of the writings, there is no good reason why an Indian should be permitted to indulge in practices which are repugnant to common decency and morality, that demands some sort of action, which of course was punitive. They want to put a stop to the demoralizing influence of, still again, that word heathens, that heathens' rights. So the dances that we had to celebrate, and the other piece that became even more detrimental is the loss of those people who were the protectors and the observers and the mediators, right? Because those roles were not fully functional in our tribes the way they were at one time. Here is a drawing. This is 1850. It's a chief, also known as a pine leaf. This is someone who was born female and who took on the role of a male warrior. We do know that she learned horse keeping, building, some of those things that we think are more traditionally male. So hunting, warfare. She had four female wives. And had a very strong voice in their community. So we go from pictures. This is 1886, and there are the circle up there. You can't see very well, but the circle up here is actually two women, right? So they're born female, and have chosen to take on that role of what they consider to be male, and this was perfectly acceptable. Perfectly, if you want to use the word normal, it was accepted that this is who we are. This is 1890, and this is a woman who was born male. So today, you know, we have a whole different language for this. At this time, it was just photos and whatever names that whatever the artist wanted to say, call them. This is two Lakota women who live together. They're in their 90s in this picture, but they lived together most of their lives until they died. This is on the Charlie would be the person in the skirt who took on that role, born male, and took on the role of weaving, which is something that an outsider would look at and say that's a female job, right? So this is the same person, and she's in a funeral dress in this picture, 1928. And so a lot of these, I was a little bit afraid of time because so many of these are visual. But every one of these, I think, is so important because it reinforces those stories that we heard in the oral traditions, and then we have this, right? So these are two men from Moose Mountain who lived together and shared their lives together. Wiwa is from the Zuni Nation, was born male, chose, again, what they considered to be female. Roles of weaving and pottery. And Wiwa actually learned a particular style of weaving that would have been lost to the tribe, except for her, that she was able to save that. And Ojibwe, they had a system of beliefs that not only there were more than the two genders, so someone's not male and they're not female, but they're an inanimate and animate. So just a different, very different language and thought about what we call these two-spirit. and here is a Navajo man who combined, he was a medicine man and also worked with, again, what would be traditionally female art. And roles. So I think it's very interesting in a lot of ways in that since even the very first, one of the very first paintings that I showed you about the men being attacked, I think that's another reason that we have so many men, right? Because who was documenting our history but men, and what would be more offensive than a man doing female work or those roles? So I think that's interesting. There's very few pictures that we see of women, born women, who then take on the male role. So I talked about the religious freedom and that that was not changed until 1978. And we actually went, it was 1978 before we actually were allowed to have our own religious ceremonies. Our feathers are sacred objects. Before then, as I said, it was illegal. And so when we, as tribal people, got the religious freedom back, then a shift started to occur in that with that religious freedom was the spirituality aspect that reincorporated two-spirit people back into our communities. So after 1978, with that reemergence, with the ability to then have our own ceremonies and to begin to practice again. So the 70s were a time when the LGBTQ or the two-spirit people came together and did start creating their own organizations. So one of the earliest was Gay American Indians in San Francisco. There are several. There's two-spirit gatherings all over the United States, Canada, for different ceremonies, different times, different sacred times of ceremony. Lots of two-spirit organizations. And again, this is just a list of them. There are so many more than what I've listed. I just kind of picked a bunch. from here. So this seems kind of dated, this picture. But when I found this, I was very happy because this is from 2009. It was one of the first times that I actually saw an article that talked about Native American Two-Spirit people, right? So this article in here is about gay and transgender Native Americans finding acceptance in their own in our own traditions. So I was excited about that. And then we had some of the older pictures, and here we have pictures of more modern Two-Spirit people. Oh, this next one, I'm going to go, that one. All right, so that was very specific. They're actually, that organization in Indiana has merged, and they're now part of a Northeast Northeast Society that encompasses Indiana, Ohio, and some of these other regions in this area. And so the purpose of the Two-Spirit organization is to teach our history, the best that we know it, to the next generations. So there's traditional arts, dancing, drumming, there's HIV testing, the sexually transmitted infection education, recreating community, a lot of this, while I talk about what is, what used to be and how things are now, there certainly, it doesn't speak for every single tribe that is out there. There are tribes who might have more of that Christian belief. So so people who come out might not be accepted in their own community. So I was worried about all the pictures because I thought I had one more. All right, so anyways, I thought I had more pictures. So I want to talk about a little bit about kind of where we are now. I wanted to, there was a woman, a Two-Spirit woman, who was actually on the tribal council in Oklahoma of a medium-sized tribe who passed away. She lived her life always in that community as a woman. A lot of people didn't know until after she died that she was actually born male. So even today, a lot of our tribes do accept Two-Spirit people. I saw, and I didn't get permission to show a picture of this, but I really wanted to. But like this necklace I have, I saw some that are like this, a little bit larger. But they're beaded, and it says him, his, and she, hers. So I thought that was really amazing that even in our traditional arts, those are shifting, right? So that is also shifting. And I am done a little bit. I was trying to speak slowly. but it's the middle of six kids, that very rarely happens. Anyway, so I want to thank you for having me. So. Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead. Footloose and fancy free.
Thank you.
Yeah. So earlier you were talking about Two-Spirit words not being in the classroom and not having to be something to learn, like in its own right. Hmm. So in day-to-day life, is that something, like after finding it, something to be reintroduced? Is that something that only specific people would learn?
Okay, so. So then the question is about language, and as we are reintroducing and maybe even relearning our language, is that something that only specific people know? Is that was your question? Okay. No, I think it's these words are generally accepted and shared. What I found in my experiences are that some of the elders, particularly those who have been closer to their native traditions, are much more open and accepting than maybe some younger natives who might be separated from their culture and taking on whatever beliefs they believe are right, maybe.
Do you know of any community service centers geared toward Native American population?
Okay, so community service centers geared towards Native American population. I know there's one in Cleveland, and it just really depends on what city you're at, because most large cities now have space for Two-Spirit. We also have our Native American or tribal-owned healthcare centers that has also done a good job of incorporating like HIV, STI awareness. And so the answer is yes. There's lots. If someone wanted one specifically, I guess we can both do the Google together, try to find it.
How does one become Two-Spirit? Is it a spiritual designation, inherited choice?
All right. So so the question is, how does one become Two-Spirit? And whether it's a designation or a choice, this really very much varies from tribe to tribe. Some tribes at about age 11, 12, 13, some tribes have a ceremony that's basically a basket or a bow. And so at that young, maybe preteen or early teenage years, that person would select which path or which parts of their tradition that they wanted to learn. So it was a female who chose the bow, that would be more along the lines of choosing those male tasks. And so that's something that's, it's not specific to my tribe, but there are some tribes who do have that ceremony where the child selects for themselves. And that's part of the whole family and the community.
Do you believe this knowledge could be helpful to today's trans teenagers who have high suicide rates and are looking for acceptance?
Absolutely. I mean, I think particularly the message of survival in and of itself, the fact that we used to be, you know, I don't know, maybe 100% or close to 100% of the population in the United States, and now we're 2%, right? That is a strong line of survival. And so it is about reclaiming who we are and reclaiming our traditions. And absolutely, I think at any time when we can reclaim that and name that and define those for ourselves, that we will be better off as tribal people. All right.
Many of the native terms you showed us were male-bodied. Mm-hmm. Is the male bias because males are more valued in Native culture, or does it show the bias of the colonizers who collected the terms?
Yeah. All right. So then again, of all the names that I showed you from the different tribes, many of them were, as pointed out in the question, was they were about the male body, and that the what was the other part of that question?
Is it because males
right.
are more valued in
right? Okay, so the question is if males are more valued in Native culture, or if that had to do with the colonizers. So that would be very much, in my opinion, has to do with the colonizers. Because in our tribal nations, we're matriarchal. So the names are passed down through the female side. If a man marries, a man marries a female, then they would go to live with that female's family in their tribe. So basically the male would give up their space and actually go, they would be the one basically changing their name and changing their life rather than the way that we usually see that.
It seems like the rise of Two-Spirit and LGBTQ identity in Native American community coincides with the 70s gay liberation movement. Are you aware of any documentation of Native Americans participating in that movement?
Lots. Yeah, so just in general, the 1970s and the gay liberation movement. And yeah, so the question was, am I aware of any of the link between American Indians and that movement? And absolutely. I mean, especially founding with the gay American Indians in San Francisco have always been at the forefront of that movement and change. So.
Two spirits. Is there any one spirit more prominent than the other?
No. So the question is, among two spirits, is there one that's more prominent than the other? It's about balance, right? So that whole circle is about balance. And that can shift with the different roles that someone is doing at that moment in time. But again, it's not linear, so it's not just male or female or good or bad. It's everything in between. So for us, it's more fluid than maybe the language that is used. So, I mean, I think that's kind of where we're going in the future, is not only reclaiming our language, but defining and creating our own words. In my native language, the word for auntie and the word for mom is the exact same, right? We don't have a word for goodbye. It's like, you know, we're going to see each other again. I mean, it's more of a proclamation. So I think that's kind of maybe the next steps is not just reclaiming, but defining these words and these experiences for ourselves.
You mentioned that two-spirit is a modern term. Can mm-hmm. you explain how modern?
Well, probably maybe late 70s or early 80s. So the term two-spirit is relatively new. It was, I don't even know where it originated, but it was something that simply that did catch on. And there's lots of discussion and debate about what it means. And again, because it's two-spirit, it's that dichotomy, which does not really go in line with the fluidity, but it's stuck. It's stuck around, so yeah. So that's just something else that we're creating. And another thought I had about the question about the men, particularly with the language of male, the focus on men, is they have to remember who was creating our language for us, right? It was men, right? The women were not, and I'm talking about what's a nice word for people that took our country? The colonizers, that's a nice word. Okay, so the colonizers, and even up into the 1900s, you know, a lot of women didn't read and write. There was no value for the female. It was the men who were writing the history. It was the men who were documenting this for us. So if there were translators between the native language and English language, you know, again, it was men, so of course it would be male focused, right? So anyways. So my the very first time that I spoke in public, I was much younger, but I was not even like second or third. I was like, oh my gosh, like the first 15 people didn't show up, can you speak? And I was like, yeah, okay. And it was in Chicago, and it was a huge, huge, like maybe 1,000 people. And I called my mom, and I was so excited. And I said, Mom, I'm going to speak at blah, blah, blah about my research. And she was quiet for a minute, and she just goes, oh, well, don't talk too long. And so I just feel like I've spoken very quickly, and she would be very proud of me today. So. Well, I'm easy to find if you come up with more questions. But again, I do want to thank you very much. I was a professor for 10 years, and so it's every time I'm now in front of a group, I'm like a little bit nervous, and I used to not be at all. As I said, I've spoken in crowds all over the world, but it's been a while. So anyways, but again, as I started, I said, you know, the only equalizer that we have is time. And I really am very grateful for the Cummings Center and also the Portage Path Collective, and also very grateful for all of you who showed up to share this evening with me. Thank you.